Hello, boys and girls. Grab yourself something to drink, get comfortable. In this video, we are going to talk about spherical coordinates, of course, super important in a lot of physical applications. And we are also coming at this from a SO2 Lie group or quaternion perspective. We are going to talk about actions of the Lie group in represented by 2x2 complex matrices, but acting on the physical space and how that works. And for that, some of this video is also just working with basic rotation matrices and explaining how spherical coordinates come about in a way that enables us to understand how that actually works, how that connects, that suddenly you have this complex lower dimensional structure, lower than three dimensional representations. I would say, let's just get into it. I have a bunch of videos on Lie groups in general, but in particular, I have several long videos on rotations, and they cover sort of different topics. For example, these two videos are basically about the exponential map, and very general, not necessarily just the SO3 rotation group. And then I have the discussion about rotation matrices versus axis angles and these theorems. And so if you're interested in that, if you want to see me play around with this coordinate system and explain some things, these are also relevant videos. But this video is more on the complex side, in the sense of complex representations, than these videos. Before we get into it, of course, I have a bunch of links that are relevant. As always, there are about like 10 different Wikipedia articles just about the rotation group. It's evident that the Wikipedia authors didn't really know how to classify all this information, because it's such a huge topic and they split it up in a sort of random way. So I can only mention a few of them. A lot of them are helpful. So there's one about the rotation representation theory of SO2, and here you see these 2x2 matrices, this basis for Hermitian matrices in the end, up to a factor. So this also relates to Pauli matrices in physics. They are defined like that. So these are these Hermitian matrices. We are going to encounter them in this video as well. And everything I do in this video also will be relevant for the video I am preparing on the spherical pendulum as well. The sort of main things that we are getting at in this video is what you see here. Mostly these two matrices. We want to understand the application of these two matrices in the action of SU2, although not exactly as we have it here. And we will also encounter this and try to understand, like, you might know the rotation matrix, the 3x3 rotation matrix, but we want to get a little bit familiar with it and see the connection to these smaller representations. So I might come back to this Wikipedia page a little bit later on. Okay, and in the end, I also talk about, I mentioned some quantum mechanical applications that sort of mirror the situation we have here, the Bloch sphere and this sort of diagram. And we are also going to work with this sort of diagram. And I will mention at the end, everything I do here is relevant for mechanics in general. And I'm at the moment more interested in the classical mechanics, but it will also have these applications to qubits. Okay, and then there are also, apart from the group theoretical, directly group theoretical Wikipedia articles, there are some helpful articles. Like here, there's the Nabla operator in various coordinate systems. These come in handy sometimes. If you want to look it up, it's good to know. I want to point out that there are these pages that might be helpful if you just need to come across the situation where you want to compute this. And there's not just that, right? There's even more of these sort of articles that summarize sort of rules that can be derived from basic linear algebra and analysis. So, you know, if you go there, you find also an article on vector fields in cylindrical and spherical coordinates and these kind of things. And there's also a nice article on matrix calculus, and then there's, like, you know, there's these tables on Laplace transforms, and it's good to know that this exists. So I want to make an effort and point people to it. But okay, we're not going to need that actually. And so with that, let's get into it. So I spoiler you a little bit what we're going to see. We're first going to discuss rotations in general. I want to make a point between extrinsics and extrinsics rotations and some of the ambiguities that hinder some people to understand rotations properly and why they are like perceived as difficult. And they are difficult, but so I want to highlight some of the things that so people can get a little bit straight on what we're going to see. And then we're going to derive really spherical coordinates and see how it relates to what we saw before on the rotation matrices, and understand, try to make a bridge between this like 3D situation, this very like geometrical three-dimensional situation, and complex multiplications. I talk about unitary actions in the abstract for one section. And then I get to the SU2 action as it applies to spherical coordinates. And I finish with a little remark on qubits. So it's probably going to be an hour video, but I think I put together some nice insights. Okay, so let's start by getting some conventions down. As I said, there are some ambiguities and decisions to be made that sometimes end up confusing people's use of rotations in whatever representation. Conventionally, I think for the whole text, I only set up rotations which really go, like, have this right-handed angle with respect to the axis where they're defined. If not, then I might have overseen something, but it's good to be aware of that, of course. If you have an axis, then this alone does not really specify the rotation around the axis. You have to speak about in which direction the rotation goes, and by that what is meant is, of course, the orientation of the axis. So you have an axis here and you say it points in this direction and you do the rotation like this, right? Okay, you are aware of that. So this is like, if you to tie immediately to the complex analysis situation where multiplication by complex numbers on the unit circle correspond to rotations of complex numbers, there we would have the situation that complex multiplication is defined to rotate counterclockwise. And so with the right hand rule, that would mean that the axis would be pointing towards you out of the complex plane. And this is the rotation. Okay. Then there is this situation where you can speak about extrinsic rotation versus intrinsic rotations. And I'm going to say more about that in a second. And finally, when I speak about matrix rotations, I consider these matrices, in all my language, I consider these matrices to act actively and rotate objects in space. And together with the extrinsic convention, that means we fix a coordinate system and rotate objects around with respect to the axis there. Okay, so what do we mean by extrinsic versus intrinsic rotations, right? These are like, there are like various, there's like a lot of conventions in which you can state rotations to begin with, but they all end up with you being able to state a general rotation by stating three angles and three axes around these axes, where the rotation are by these angles around these axes. And so there are like two major distinctions, namely of whether or not you want to fix the coordinate system up front, the extrinsic convention, or specify the rotations by considering axes that are determined by the angles themselves. So I'll tell you what I mean in a second. What I show you now, this image, this GIF, that is also available on Wikipedia, is an intrinsic rotation. So this video starts here and performs three rotations, and in the end this ball is turned around. Okay, I give you a few seconds to stare at it. And what I want to emphasize is that we start with this blue axis, right? I will call this, I think, X, Y, and Z axis, okay? So when I refer to the axis, this is always X, this is always Y, this is always Z. So what we see here, for example, it starts out with a rotation like that around the Z axis, right? And then the second rotation, however, is around this the axis when he is red now. And the point is that this axis around which the second rotation happens is not one of the blue axes with which I started, but the axis of rotation here is actually obtained by taking the x-axis and having it be rotated by the first rotation as well, right? So what happens here, this is an intrinsic rotation because the object always rotates by an axis system that is defined or moves with the object itself, right? So this object moves by, I don't know, 60 degrees in the counterclockwise direction around the Z axis, and thereby defines a new axis of rotation, which is, it's one of its body axis, right? So the problem is I cannot stop this GIF here, but if you would freeze it at the beginning before it rotates around Z the first time, then this axis around which it rotates is really just the X axis, but when it actually comes to rotating around this X axis, the X axis has already been moved as well, right? So you can think of this as intrinsic because if you have if you have a phone like to an application which has a gyroscope or something like that, then let's say you are in not speak about the gravity, but because gravity is fixed with respect to the world coordinate system, but if you are in space and you have a sensor which notices rotation, for example, and a gyroscope, then the object would only know of its own coordinate system, right? The object it has no sense for a global coordinate system that you changed up front. So when you rotate it, then these all the rotation axes, it can only speak of them with respect to itself, in the same way that this ball would speak about rotation axis in terms of itself, right? So it starts out in a certain way, and it will first rotate through its Z axis, going out of its head, and then it will rotate about an axis looking to going out on the side of it, even if from our outer perspective that axis has been moved by the first rotation already. Okay, I'm talking around the bush here. I guess that point is hopefully clear. So there are these two rotations, and then there's a third rotation. The third rotation here also happens around the Z axis, but by the time the rotation around the second time that it rotates around the Z axis, that intrinsic Z axis, the Z axis has already moved. Okay. So that's here. This is here the intrinsic situation I have found on the internet. Here, this is another link where you can watch up the same rotation, but in this case, it also shows some angles. Disregard the names of the angles because this angle will be called phi. This name will be theta for us, and the third angle will be called psi, but it will not be so relevant for us. Okay, so here you see this is very nice, where you see how it takes off, and so these angles. These are these Euler angle conventions that are often stated in this body fixed intrinsic system. Okay, so that said, the interesting thing is now that these intrinsic or extrinsic conventions are equivalent. There are some transformations, transformations of rotation matrices that get you from the composition of the form of three rotation matrix to another composition of three different rotation matrices, which are similar. So I will motivate this here by this picture. This is also taken from a Wikipedia page. I can actually look it up where I have this taken over from. So here you see, I also posted later here. So this is up in this Davenport. This is some usually aircraft engineering terminology that has become big in this field, even if it's math. This is a picture from there, and here you see this interesting equivalence of these two conventions explicitly. So here we are going to compare now the intrinsic and the extrinsic conventions just to convince ourselves that we can choose to work in either, okay, and that they are simply related. Here we have a situation, never mind names of the variables, although in this case they even work out for us. But so here we have the situation that we have this intrinsic situation where the blue coordinate system, thankfully it's again blue, is given to us, and the first rotation is by minus 60 degrees around the z axis. So our conventions is positive, so meaning that if this is a minus 60, then it rotates clockwise, because our convention is counterclockwise. This is minus 60, so it rotates clockwise. So if you think of a vector here, it's rotated by, this is about 60 degrees, right? There, and this is the first rotation. Then the second rotation is, because we're in the intrinsic system, is around this, the x-axis, so we go from z to x, but the x-axis in the intrinsic system, which has already been rotated, so this whole thing tilts over a little bit. I hope you have the cognition to have this like a geometric picture of this in your head. And finally, we end with another rotation around z again. So this is also z x z, same as we had it in this situation here, right? Here you start with z, we do an x, we do a set again. So this is the same sort of scheme, and rotate it. So here this was by 30 degrees and here by 45 degrees. So this comes over a little bit there. Okay. And now we have the extrinsic situation, and the extrinsic situation ends, like the composition of all these three rotations will end up with the same rotation as you see here. The final point is the same picture. The same orientation, but what we do here is we only do rotations around the fixed axis. So we start with, again, we start with a rotation around z, but in this case the first rotation is actually a positive one. So I'm a little bit confused because they don't have the sorry, this is wrong. Let me go to the website, because these numbers are not correct, I think. Yeah, I've mixed the numbers up. So I've taken this from here, this example, and the numbers should be here, 45, 30, 60. So I flipped this, sorry. The good thing is I recognize it immediately, which speaks for the truth of the statements. So the first rotation is here a positive one, which means the first rotation is indeed counterclockwise as our conventions, 45 degrees over there. Then comes a minus 30 rotation in it's not minus 30. My God, what am I doing? So, sorry, this is still not correct, because the minus sign must be the 60. I now notice that this was indeed a positive convention for our conventions. That's why I was confused about the minus 30. So again, I see that this didn't match out, work out. Okay, but now it's correct. Okay, so first the positive rotation in 45 degrees, then the positive rotation at 30 degrees, just a little bit tilting the whole situation. And then, and you see, as opposed to what we had before, what we do now is actually rotating around this fixed blue axis. We don't, like here, rotate about the intrinsic body fixed axis of the object, but here we rotate around the fixed axis, the extrinsic, around the axis of the extrinsic coordinate system. And finally, we do the another rotation around the z axis, again, the fixed extrinsic axis by minus 60. So this thing rotates so that these feet are looking at us. These 2 feet here are like coming closer to us from a viewing perspective. And interestingly, you see the starting rotation was, you know, axis aligned. Then the three rotations happen, and we end up with the same situation with rotations around, in these two cases, different axis conventions, extrinsic versus intrinsic, intrinsic versus extrinsic. And the angles, however, are obviously super related, right? We just switch these two around and we get the same sort of thing. And so indeed, the claim is, of course, that both of these like extrinsic and intrinsic are equivalent. You can find matrices that are extrinsic or intrinsic, whatever you like, and still can decompose every rotation in three parts in the way this is done here for this particular total rotation. And so it's just as a motivation, and you can see a little bit more about that on the Wikipedia site, but also not too much, why this is like not extremely surprising that this works is the following. You can take the identity and decompose it like that right here. This is just rewriting identity matrix, let's say. This works for every like invertible objects, but here before, 3 times 3 matrices, you're like z to the power of minus 1, then y, then here this is a 1. And so you can write the identity as this thing. And so if you take x, y, z, and these are like 3 rotation matrices, and add the identity from the left, so x, y, z times, and what we have here, then what we have here is 3 new objects which are obtained by like this transposition, you know, this transformation from like our set prime prime is defined as this object, and this is basically the set rotation, but like pre-composed and post-composed with some rotations. It basically turns to the body system, does the rotation that it did before, and then it turns it back, and so on and so forth. So that's how that works. So that's how you can, if you want to like compute, go in both directions. So the whole point of this talk, basically, up until now, was to motivate you that this is not really scary. Like you might see this situation and you might think, oh my God, what is the rotation around this body fixed axis, blah blah blah, but we can just think in terms of the extrinsic coordinate systems. That's what we're going to do in the rest of the video. And also, like, all these conventions are basically arbitrary. There are like half a dozen or more like conventions how you do the sequences. In this video it was z and some angles, and that's also what we are going to use. Actually, we're going to use less in the end because we are not really interested in the whole three-dimensional SO true for the most part. There's a lot of freedom, but in principle, that's basically how it works. I hope this takes a little bit of the scariness out of it. All these rotations, like all these rotations, are composed of free rotations. Like any rotation is composed of a sequence of free rotations that all look essentially like rotation in two-dimensional systems with one axis that you can choose to be one of the extrinsic coordinate axes. So here, this example was this extrinsic z-xz sequence, right? This is this last example, so extrinsic and with conventions z-xz. And so that means I suppose you know how like a rotation in three dimensions about a fixed axis looks like, because it's basically just the rotations in two dimensions, the plane. This is like a simple rotation matrix. And then a one on the third axis, because every rotation has all the vectors on its axis as eigenvectors, right? So this is also then clear that this has determinant one and so on. Mm-hmm. And So I think that this motivates why every rotation can be written like this. Rotation over set, and if you multiply that together, this is like a boring task, then you get this thing, and this is one way how a general rotation matrix can look like, right? But if you choose, of course, different conventions and whatnot, then this might look a little bit different, might be the transpose or not, and what so on and so forth. So for example, here we have a minus sign, for example, but if you look at I don't know, did I have a let me see if I have this. Let's go to the I don't know, rotation matrix 3D. I'm pretty sure that we have here on this Wikipedia page an example of a rotation matrix, and it's likely to be not the same convention, right? So, well, now I'm just on the same side. This was not very okay. So here I'm on the orthogonal group. This is of course a little bit a broader class, but I'm hopeful that here we also will find come across around a general 3x3 rotation matrix. Okay, it looks like. No, sorry, you know, I don't want to hold myself up, but the point of course being that if you would do some other sequence, like you first do x-axis, then y, blah, 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 then of course you get something which looks similar like that, in the sense that it is like each component is a sum of products up to three like trigonometric functions. But they are essentially all of this sort of form. Okay, what we are going to do next, what we need to eventually to get towards the SO2 is, for understanding, we will derive how spherical coordinates work. And you might have seen this before, but I promise you there's a point to that, to highlight some of the features that become relevant later. So we have a general point P in a normal system that is like the God-given coordinate system that we start with components x, y, and z. And we want to express this in terms of spherical coordinate system, meaning the radial distance is one feature, and then two angles. So this is also why I said we are not going to actually need for the most part, the whole three-dimensional rotation group, because what we are going to have is one parameter, that's a real parameter going radially. And so we only have to move really in two spherical, sorry, that's the beer, in two dimensions on the surface of the sphere, right? So here is the conventions, very close to what we, the situation that we had before, of naming conventions, right? So we're going to have one angle coming down from the z-axis. Like the z-axis will be our reference axis in the whole video. And then one angle that goes away from x, meaning that this angle is a rotation around the z-axis. And in terms of the what we saw before with the rotations, this would be to get there. For example, you could turn anything around this, and then turn it around an axis which would somehow lie in the xy plane. But the good thing is that for the most part we don't have to think about like what goes first and so on and so forth, because what we are going to do is we think of this point on the sphere like now set R2 1, right? We are just interested in covering, finding all points on the sphere of distance 1 from the origin, set R2 1, and how, like, from the picture it's sort of obvious how do we get from any point to any other point. We are going to start at the unit vector in Z. And how do we get from a unit vector from Z to any other point? Well, we are going to first tilt down, and we are going to first tilt down towards the x-axis, right? So our first rotation is going to be from the unit vector, let's say somewhere here, Towards the x-axis, meaning the first rotation is a rotation around the y-axis, becoming closer to the x-axis with the z unit vector. And then, so it's tilted forward. And then we are going to rotate the whole space, including that point, around the z-axis so that it gets over there, right? Does it make sense? So if this is the coordinate system, this is the unit vector in z, which just and this is the z-axis, this is my x-axis coming towards you, this is the y-axis. I'm first rotating around the y-axis, coming closer to you, and then I have this tilted forward, and I'm going to rotate around the z-axis and going to any point there. And like visually, at least, it's obvious that I can find any point in this way, right? I start with the unit vector in z-direction. I do a tilt forward, the tilt can go basically to the north pole even, out of the south pole down. So this is the angle theta can be between 0 and pi. And the angle phi can go between 0 and 2 pi once around. And in this way, we have parameterized all points, right? Of course, phi 0 and 2 pi is the same, so we can exclude 2 pi. But we're not like really concerned much about this boundaries in this video. So that's what we do. Right? I've already described, and here I also write this down now a little bit more formally. And what I want to emphasize is how the formulas have this sort of complex multiplications, complex rotation structure in them. So what we do, we want to reach every point in R3. I argue that we just need to reach every point in S2 and then multiply with some R to reach every point. We start with EZ 0, 0, 1, right? That's the unit vector in Z direction and rotate around Y, we tilt forward. This leaves the Y value unchanged, right? Well, if I rotate forward, then for whatever vector I obtain from the unit vector in Z, as of now, it has no Y component. Okay, then how to compute this value? Well, it's a rotation, so it's given by this standard rotation matrix. You can do the computation algebraically. Here's the argument why it's sine, cosine. Like if you know that it's a trigonometric function, then you start with, this norm one vector, it points upwards. After a tiny tilt forward, it will be still close to one. So this x direction will become the cosine, right? Because it's cosine for small angles is something that's a little bit smaller than one. And in the forward x direction, the contribution is square root of one minus whatever it has in the z direction. So this is a sine, right? So after the first rotation inside of the x z plane, we have, I mean, this is like, again, it's super obvious, but I think if you emphasize it and you start thinking about it, it helps if you go to the more complex situation later. Okay, and what do we do now? We take whatever you have in this XZ plane and rotate it into getting a component in the Y coordinate system. So we rotate now around the Z axis, and what we get is we have another rotation matrix. It introduces another sine and cosine term. But since we, like as you can see in the picture here, since we have tilted it forward, rotate around z-axis, and the rotation around the z-axis leaves the z-axis invariant. Yeah? All these vectors here around the z-axis are eigenvectors for the rotation matrix with eigenvalue 1. Nothing will happen to the z-axis. So the z-axis will remain the cosine. But now we introduce another cosine and sine from the next rotation. And so for small angles, again, we have a small angle in phi now. Now the x component will be reduced slowly a little bit, right? It was in the plane, but now it will move towards this direction, it will move in a circle. So this will necessarily, because it shrinks a little bit again, will be multiplied by this cosine term, right? So what do we get? Previously we had in x direction sine, and now this gets reduced because it starts rotating away. It gets a cosine term. So this is this here. This gets multiplied by cosine term, and then the other component to keep the norm at one, to ensure that this rotation doesn't change the norm overall. This is another sign here, right? So suddenly, previously there was like there was nothing in y direction, but now this sign appears here, and to like have everything worked out with the norm, you can compute how big the component in this direction is, and it must be this multiplication of the signs. Okay, so this is the derivation of this column here, right? So this is we basically made a generic rotation as far as these two angles are concerned, right? And we obtained this. So this means also that for the rotation that we did as a whole matrix, this vector must be the third column of the rotation matrix, right? Because let's say you have the matrix R, which is a 3x3 matrix, and you apply it to this thing. We know that it takes this thing, 0, 0, 1, to this. And then if you multiply the rotation with the vector, you find out, oh, this must be the third component of this rotation matrix. And you also see this mirrored here. Like, for example, here, like this is some other convention maybe. Yeah? I don't know in which direction this goes. It took this literally from here, but here you can see that these third, you see the pattern here, right? Here might be a minus sign again. This is some conventions, but if you see the situation, you know now why there is this cosine there, because the first rotation, this comes basically from the first rotation there, that affects it, right? So you can also, I mean, you can do this calculation again by hand. You can say, apply this sequence of three matrices to 0, 0, 1. The first rotation is a rotation around a set itself. So the 0, 0, 1 is left unchanged, and then multiply it with this, and this is how the cosine comes from here to there and so on. And so that's why the third column is basically so brave and simple, and these might be a little bit more complicated, but anyway. And here we also see how the whole procedure that we just did can be extended to find this generic rotation, right? Because imagine you take the situation here that we just described here, and you have some object, some generic object lying. Imagine a big teddy bear which lies somewhere how in the coordinate system. It's easier to imagine if you imagine it very close to the center, maybe being in the center, and we have described these two rotations, one forward and one around the z-axis. And if you now imagine, before you do even the first forward rotation, before you do that, now do actually a rotation around the z-axis, right? Then you change everything before you even start to tilt, and this has then the same effect as this has then the same effect as if you would do first what we tilting forward and moving over, and then rotate everything about the body system, right? Okay, maybe I'm not sure if I explained this correctly, but I'm sure I explained it correctly, but I'm not sure if it was so easy to understand. Do we have some interesting thing here to rotate? Okay, no, well, let's just take this thing. This is like a man. So the rotation in two dimensions that we described is as follows. We tilt forward, and then we rotate around the z-axis like so. And then the man, so it looks like that. So I'm not sure if you can see this. So again, the rotation is like forward and then to the side. If you now, before you tilt even forward, rotate around, like a little bit around the z-axis, and then do the rotations, right? This is tilting forward and like so, then the whole situation is a little bit flipped, but you can correct it again by turning it back around the body axis, and then it is as if you never did this pre-rotation around the z-axis. Okay. I don't want to hold myself up too much with that, but I hope that that sort of makes sense. It's how you like can see that by just doing one rotate, like one extrinsic coordinate system rotation from the start, this is then similar to doing an intrinsic rotation at the end. Okay. Good. Okay. So we have obtained this this sort of vector, and again, I want to emphasize that if you take a complex plane rotation and you multiply by a complex number with unit norm, then it's basically you multiply by e to the power of I times an angle, and I times an angle is just cosine of that angle plus I sine of that angle, right? And here in these two rotations around this extrinsic frames, we also had this situation, right? We do the first rotation, we get sine and cosine. And then we do another rotation and we get another sine and cosine in. And then in the end, everything must be normed. So there is all is determined how all these coefficients look like. But there is then this, of course, Lie group theoretical like formalization that sort of brings actions by Lie group's elements into the same sort of language, like in the same language that multiplication by a complex unit, complex number is given by multiplication with e to the I theta. The general theory of exponential functions in Lie groups generalizes these whole situations, but not to just rotating around angles in this in the standard two-dimensional plane sense, but gives you a general formalism for all this move manifold-like groups. And indeed, also here in this situation, even with 3 times 3 matrices, although we don't talk about it in this video, have, of course, this sort of generators which look like that. And here, this is the point that I'm making here. So this amounts to 2 rotations in of this form, where A is always something that leaves one of the axes invariant. Okay, so yeah, this is the point that I made with this, that we can also like complete this by doing one more rotation at the start, and then we have all the rotations that we could do. Okay, and now we do a little bit of a break for something completely different, and we take a step back, and now we go into the world of algebras with invertible elements. Okay, so I'm going step by step there. And I start very abstractly. So this section will in a priori not have to do with any angle things, but in the section thereafter, we'll connect all the things. So here I start out with defining this function of, let's think about it in terms of invertible matrices. So GL, whatever you want, complex numbers in some dimension. And we have this operation, which is just matrix multiplication and this conjugate transpose. So this should mean you, if their entries are complex, you do take the complex conjugate of every element and to transpose the matrix. This is some simple function defined by 2 products. You know how to multiply these complex matrices. You know how to transpose. It's all super simple to compute. It's a trivial operation. And now we want to observe some properties of this in general and then impose further restrictions, okay? So first observation, if I do the conjugate of the whole thing, right? Because this is a mapping from 2 matrices to another matrix of the same type, GL, CN. If I do this and use the rules for like transposition, then you get here 2 transposes here. And this is an involution, so I get G P star G star, and then I use the definition of it again and see, oh, this is this. So this means if P is self-adjoint, Hermitian operation, and self-adjoint and Hermitian for matrices. Sorry for my pronunciation again, but let's say self-adjoint. They are the same thing in if you don't have this difficult topology and you don't have that with matrices. So let's say self-adjoint. If P is self-adjoint, then this means that here the joint of P is P, and this means that the action leaves self-adjoint piece invariant. Okay, this is the first interesting thing that we're going to use. So if you compute the determinant of this thing, then the determinant is a homomorphism. Determinant of the products of the matrices is the product of the determinants, and here also the determinant of the conjugate transpose is the complex conjugate of the determinant. So this means the determinant computes like that, meaning that if the determinant is in U1, yeah, if this is an almost special matrix, it has a very small determinant, then this means the F operation, the action, leaves the determinant invariant. Second observation. Okay, what's more? The chaining together to P and Q that have been acted on with the same operation. I do this explicitly here. I get this thing. And also, if you compute the trace of this thing, whether the trace of the product, I can shuffle around the, like I can circle around the elements of the arguments of the trace, I get this thing. Okay. And so this all points in one direction, namely that we want to consider unitary matrices, right? Because unitary matrices have all these nice properties that makes things much easier with respect to this particular operation, this simple to compute operation, which is not too surprising because I kind of defined the operation in terms of the operation, which is also relevant for unitary operations. And also I want to emphasize that if you look at this thing here, right, the computed the trace and this product, we always had this G star G. And even if the thing is not necessarily unitary, like a priori, it's clear that for this operation to simplify, it actually doesn't really matter what the overall phase of this matrices is. So based on the observation that if G is unitary, this is just unity, and we have all the nicest properties that we want. We can also say consider the special unitary matrices, because for most of these properties, the overall phase would cancel out anyway, right? So we can set determinant to one or determinant to phase. Doesn't really matter for a lot of this operation. I just wanted you to notice that. In the what's next, the last part basically, we're going to focus in on SU n's anyway, and in particular we're going to focus in on SU2. Yeah, so in summary, with these observations, we have that just using this complex transpose and complex multiplication, we get this n by n linear representations, and by that I mean n by n is the size of each G, right? So this is just it. By linear represent, like, of course, this is a linear map for P. If you write down P as a vector, then the representation might have a higher dimension. But what I mean with n by n representation is just the size of the objects involved. Okay, so this is maybe a little bit sloppier language. I might change this to be a little bit more formal, what the n by n linear representation is here. But you see what I mean above. I just mean that the size of the, like, choosing n, we have a way of chain transforming Hermitian objects in a way that has a bunch of nice properties. These SUN have dimension n squared minus 1. You do have to take that by my word. You can do a counting argument, of course, and then you find out what the degrees of freedoms are once you apply the definition of the unitary matrices. And if we want to have that, as we had here, that they are invariant, like if you want to act on a subspace of this of the general matrices, namely we just want to use the self-adjoint arguments to this transformation, which we have proven is we are not taken out of this subclass of matrices by using F's, right? We have proven that here in this line, that using F's if you start with a self-adjoint matrices, we stay in the self-adjoint matrices. So that means we have a way of mapping around these self-adjoint matrices in a way which leaves a lot of things invariant, trace and determinant. And an even simpler counting argument tells you that there are n squared real components in this Hermitian, the space of Hermitian self-adjoint matrices, right? Because, you know, if you think of an n times n matrix, it has complex entries, so it has 2 times n times n, and the self-adjointness kills off half of the degrees of freedom. So it's n squared, which is very nice and very, like, in a way surprising, because the operation is so simple. The operation is just just flipping around components and multiplying matrices. And in particular, we are going to be interested now in SU2, which is defined as the unitary matrices in among the complex 2x2 matrices. So n is 2, there are 4 components of each matrix, but it is a 4 minus 1 is a 3-dimensional group, it's a 3-dimensional Lie groups, and it acts on a 2x2, so 2 times 2, so 4-dimensional space. So we have for sure some action of this 3-dimensional Lie group on the coordinates, I call them here S, X, Y, Z, leaving the determinant, and you can compute this by hand very quickly. Just take the determinant and trace of a Hermitian matrix, leaves these nice things invariant. And this action then is indeed not trivial, but is actually, this 3-dimensional Lie group is actually then a cover, like a two, like, yeah, it's basically the rotation group, except like a 2-dimensional, like, a double cover of the rotation group. I want to get my terminology right, but if you look at the homotopy, then you find out there's difference between SO2 and SO3. But for all these small angles that we are interested in here, effectively they do the same job. In a way, the SU2 is the nicer and bigger group, but not in terms of dimension. And we are now going to make use of this, you know, without proof that the SU2 has this has this homomorphism into the rotation group. Arguably, a degree of freedom is lost in a sine convention sort of way. But since we are interested here in the rotations in the 3-dimensional space, and we are coming from the bigger, you know, I say bigger, but I don't mean the bigger in terms of the dimension, but bigger in terms of covering. Since we're coming from this the SU2. We get the full image or in the SO3 Lie group. Okay. If I would have written down some notes, I could say this a little bit more clearer in terms of homomorphism. But so you have to deal with my hand wavy description. But I guess it's best if we move on, you see how this actually then happens here in practice. Okay, so now we connect the two things. We take the SU2 and spherical coordinates and look at the points in the 4-dimensional space, right? We just have established that we have this nice 3-dimensional group of transformations in a 4-dimensional space. Actually, we are only interested in 3-dimensional space in this video, right? So we will immediately cancel this S parameter. But clearly, the self-adjoint matrices can be parameterized like this, right? If you take the transpose and do the complex conjugate, this thing with the plus comes down there, but then you take the conjugate, it becomes a minus. So this is a self-adjoint matrix, and you can clearly go in both directions. If you take the trace of this matrix, the set cancels out, and then you know S, and then you can subtract the S from the diagonal, and then you can read off what Z is and so on and so forth. So this is a bijection of just these four real parameters. And now we are going to take a look at what our starting vector that we used to find all points on the two sphere is going to get mapped at. So we start with this set. We extend it like formally here by this one dimension, but the projection from this four-dimensional space to the three-dimensional space just gives us what we want. And we embed it with this mapping into the self-adjoint matrices. And since this is x and y zero, these off-diagonals are zero, z is zero by our definition, and so this leaves us with 1, 0, 0, minus 1. So these the axis vector EZ is mapped to this fine matrix. And of course, you know, here we get into this territory here. I chose the conventions that indeed the third one, the Z axis, has this representation. Again, you can do whatever you want, right? You can flip the axis and rotate in all the directions what you want. These are this plenty of conventions, and then some matrices might look different, but here I've chosen the like physicist convention. And of course, I'm not talking about Lie-algebra much, at least not explicitly in this video, but highly related, like just up to a factor also, the Lie-algebra, you know, the Lie-algebra is a vector space at the unit of the Lie group, and these are like super related, right? Of course, this is not a self-adjoint matrix, because if you take the transpose, nothing happens, and if you take the conjugate, then you get some minus sign, so you have to multiply that by minus 1 to get sigma 3. This is the kind of the change from the practical physicist convention and then the practical abstract algebra convention. So never get confused. There's not much happening here apart from a phase, namely the unit I. But this is the same game. Okay, and so what was our PS? Well, it was this thing, right? So let me just scroll up again for you to remember P. We established that P looks like so, and in terms of the basis vectors, it looks like so. I'm going to use this thing. So this is the vector, and now I also like map this thing into like into this 2x2 matrix with this map. Okay, so Z was the simplest component. This was just the cosine. This is going to be there, s is zero, right? We don't forget about s. So here we have the cosine, and here we have x plus I ys. Okay, the sine survives because the sine is here the same. And so that means that what we can pull out is cosine plus I sine, and this is just the x, right? So this is the projection between the generic point on the two sphere in three-dimensional space and this Hermitian matrices, right? And it starts to look a little bit more scary, because I have to deal with actually complex matrices. But it's good to keep in mind that it's obvious how to go back and forth between these representations, right? This is also just a representation of three components in two angle dimensions, and that's the thing. And indeed, now comes the nice thing that we can. Oh damn it! I didn't see that I was covering up the. I didn't see that I was covering up the matrix, but given that you know that it's a Hermitian matrix, nothing surprising happened there, because you should have seen that whatever was there in this component, it must be just the complex conjugate of this component. Okay, so sorry for that. Okay, and now the interesting thing is that this thing, this whole matrix, right? This is just the generic vector on the sphere. Can be written as F for some unitary matrix. So this vector is obtained from our set vector by doing this, you know, forward tilt and side rotation. And this whole operation that we like motivated, that's why I did it so explicitly, has the correspondence, I don't know why this dot is here, has a correspondence by acting on this set vector in the Hermitian matrix representation by some SU2 representation matrix, right? With this sort of map. So it was clear up front that there is this nice three-dimensional map, but indeed this is actually the rotation. This is basically the rotation. And now we come back to the SU2 versus SU03 distinction. So the action that we have here does exactly the SU3 rotation. So nothing is lost in this direction. Indeed, this writing down the point as starting with this constant matrix representing the unit vector in the z-axis, we can obtain it by a rotation, and the rotation is obtained by multiplying from the left and from the right with this unitary transformation. This is this object, and it also decomposes into two objects. But the SU2 is actually more, because here we have now this nice, we have taken it apart into like the square root of the rotation matrix, if you will, on the one side, and the other square root on the other side. We have taken two parts now of it. And this is also then, the nice thing is then that if you want to chain rotations together, we actually don't have to deal with this ugly thing, but we can actually be a little bit more economic. We can chain 15 rotations together, and then after we've done that, apply it to a point and rotate the point around, and we didn't have to chain together all trigonometric functions that are present in the standard rotation matrix, but we can do it more economically by just computing the one side of the SU2 matrix, which is exactly the unit quaternions as well, and this is what is implemented on the computer. Okay, so I hope this was not too complicated here, but so the thing that we have motivated abstractly now indeed comes together and happens to represent as a whole rotations of points in this sort of fashion. And these U's, I have them, I've used Mathematica to compute them explicitly. They are like, one of the ways to get there is like so. This one thing is this diagonal matrix, where this is some factor, let's call it V, and here's another factor, which is V transposed, or 1 over V, and the other matrix is given like that, and this indeed corresponds to we can read it as a rotation around the set axis, right? And which is this the rotation which no sorry this is a rotation around this is a it's a rotation about one of the axes. Okay, it's a rotation about one of the axes, here I have some extra angles, because there are like various ways to get at it, right? We chosen the way of tilting Z first forward around Y and then around Z, but you can imagine there's various ways to get from this axis to that point, and corresponding with that is various conventions. And here, if you have this factor of 90 degrees around this axis, and it's like if you didn't start with the axis like that, but have the axis switched around, whatever, there's various ways to get there. This is the first one I found on Mathematica, that's why I gave it as an example. But in any case, there are like decompositions of these rotations, and this is one of them. And so this is the angle that around the z-axis, plus minus some extra angle coming from permuting or rotating up front the coordinate axes. And here's another rotation which sort of corresponds around like a rotation around this thing. And this thing was do I have the link to the Pauli matrices? Nah. But it's one of the Pauli matrices anyway. Yeah, so this was x here, and you can now play around and think deeply about what actually rotation that corresponds to, but just having used Mathematica to see that multiplying these things together indeed gives that showed me this is one of the ways to get there. Okay, so this is pretty much the this magic. We can now of course extend it also to the whole three-dimensional space by leaving the sphere, by multiplying just with a number, the same way we did it by moving from the PS2 to PR3. I'm getting annoyed by my multiplication signs here. And if you multiply this by an R, there's no problem, of course, with that, right? Multiplying by a real number will not make it not self-adjoint. And you can actually compute what the R number is by taking the determinant from this point, because this if you just use this exactly, if you just use this PS on the sphere, then the determinant of this thing itself is actually minus one or one. Yeah, if you, let's see, yeah, it's minus one, right? Cosine times minus cosine is minus cosine squared. The faces cancel out here, so the determinant of this thing, I think I've written down it here anyway, yeah, it's minus the norm. If you compute the determinant of this thing, you are left with, it's probably a minus sign here. Let me correct that maybe. Oh no, wait. It's probably a minus sign. I'm not 100% sure, but in any case, if you compute the determinant and divide it by plus minus one, then you get R, right? You can take the root. And that's that. Let me just remove the multiplication signs everywhere. So, okay. One last application of that, it's not directly an application, but it's far too close not to mention it, are like these qubits, right? So the point is that is this: if you take you might know the quantum mechanical system is modeled by Hilbert space, and the simplest one that is not super trivial is just the Hilbert space of C two for real components, a two-dimensional complex two-dimensional vector space. Standard basis vector would be these, of course, and then you think about, in quantum mechanics, the vectors have to have norm one, and so on and so forth. And the scalar product has one side complex conjugate, so overall phase is invisible. So then it turns out that the generic psi vector, right, let me write it as psi, to be a little bit more fancy here. Turns out to be of this form, and you can probably convince yourself easily that this has norm one, right? If you compute the scalar product, then you have cosine squared plus phase cancels out, sine squared is one. And this, like after seeing that these are like unitary matrices, it's not very hard to believe that you can reach this generic vector form the unit vector, right? You just need to form the unitary matrices, which has as first column cosine e sin. This is like similar to that, and you're there. So you see, you can reach all the points of interest, all the norm one vectors here, and then you see that. If you set in theta equals zero, then you have 0, 1, and if you set theta equals pi, right, then the cosine of pi half vanishes. This is killed off. Here you have 1 and da, 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 da. Yeah. Right, and then you have just a complex multiple of this one base vector, and this thing is usually represented by the so-called Bloch sphere, and it's like this sort of visual representation using exactly this parameterization for the qubits. So here, this is like the same sphere that we just discussed, and we just argued that if you set the theta angle to zero, then you are at the top, and then we are going to call this the zero base vector. And if you have the other extreme, then you get to minus to the other one, where the zero one is cancelled. It's like the term is zero, and you're just left with this. And so this is how you can also then parameterize the space of all vectors with norm one in this simple two-dimensional Hilbert space, of interest to quantum mechanics, using the same parameters, and that's how this sphere comes about. And then if you look at, I don't know, qubits, it will probably be the exact same discussion. Yeah. Here you have the same sort of notations that we have had the whole video, right? If you're wondering, right, so the SU2 has also this very interesting representation theory. I think I've opened the Wikipedia article for that as well. And it shouldn't be not that big of a surprise that you have these factors of 1/2 here, right? Because the application to get back to the rotation is applying these matrices for on both sides, right? So if you have phases that you split up in two, each of those, in a sense, only does half the job. So keep in mind here that, let's say you neglect this operation from the right here for a moment. You just consider the application of your unitary matrix. This is the unitary matrix to this matrix. This represents the unit vector and z-axis. Then the result you will get here will not be self-adjoint just yet, right? We have, of course, seen that the application of the whole thing gives you back a self-adjoint thing again. This we argued that it leaves self-adjoint matrices invariant. But only doing like a partial application of this F map gives you something which has you could say roughly it has extra phases which are not in the space of self-adjoint matrices, right? And so you have to do the whole thing to get back to the actual representation of your objects, which look like so. And but the nice thing about this whole thing is that as long as you just work with not actually applying the rotation objects to vectors, but if you just want to chain together these transformations, right? If you just want to, like, say you have an object and you say, I know that I want to chain these 17 rotations together, then you don't have to take a vector and rotate it around, but you can actually multiply just the rotations as a group. You get these kind of objects, and only at the end do this F application to that. And all these the representations on this side with where the seven transformation that you chain together, they all have this factor of 1/2 that will be remedied once you get to the actual application that does the actual rotation of actual objects. And that's why these quaternions or SO2 elements have this factor of 1/2 there. And but of course, if you are in this vector space before you take inner products to compute expectation values in Hilbert space, you deal with all these phases, and you're only dealing with applications of these objects with 1/2, and only if once you compute the quantum mechanical expectation values, gets the vector psi paired with another vector psi, which also might have this factors of 1/2, and then all this spooky 1/2 will vanish. Okay, as you can hear, I'm running out of voice. I will do definitely one video on the spherical pendulum, which is sort of the project out of which all this grew out of. I want to do one application of this representation. I want to compute the kinetical energy of a free particle in spherical coordinates using exactly these U matrices. Already have some scripts for that. Maybe I should do also a video on more formally the relationship between the SO2 and the SO3 rotation group, as it is also part of the Lie group book. So if you see me streaming, you might want to pick up the book, and I'm willing and happy to discuss some more Lie group theory with you. Okay, so with that said, I wish you a good evening.